This is a production of Stone Hill, Shadows Rising, a supernatural thriller series, Book 1, written by Dean Rasmussen, read for you by John Pirhalla. Chapter 1. Near the edge of Stone Hill, Michael's cell phone signal cut out. The intermittent text message from his friends back in California ceased, and he immediately regretted his decision to stay with his grandparents. There was nothing in the open fields that might interfere with the signal. No mountains, no large metal structures, and they weren't that far from a major highway. The cell towers must be near, and yet no signal. His grandfather slowed the car to a crawl at the edge of town. His hands gripped the steering wheel, and he leaned forward in his seat like he was driving the Daytona 500 in a dense fog. White vans were parked on both sides of the road, each facing toward the oncoming traffic. The driver of a van, dressed all in white, stood in front of his van, writing information on a clipboard as their car passed. The van's passenger looked at him through large binoculars and locked onto Michael's gaze.
"Don't look at them," his grandfather said.
Michael studied his grandfather's expression, but it was impossible to tell if he was joking. His grandfather had a permanent scowl carved onto his face, part of which had been passed down to his family and Michael's own face.
"Why not?"
"They're from the temple. Pretend they don't exist."
Michael strained toward the side mirror. The van sat beside the road like police cars waiting to pounce on speeders.
"What temple? Why are they just sitting there?"
"The Stone Hill Risen Temple. We'll talk later."
Michael held his cell phone up against the window, but the reception didn't improve.
"You won't get a signal here," his grandfather said without looking over. "Maybe if you head out toward Green Hills, but not here."
Michael rested his cell phone face up on his leg, just in case a signal bar appeared, and looked at the passing view of the lake on his right.
"The temple doesn't like it when anyone's distracted," his grandfather sneered. "Or at least that's what they tell us. Just between you and me, they aren't too happy with those little devices because they cause trouble. Someone might call for help or something. I wouldn't doubt it if they get banned altogether. But it makes no difference, because you can't make calls with them anyway."
"Do you have Wi-Fi at your house?" Michael asked.
His grandfather shot a glance at him and raised one corner of his mouth.
"That's all gone. That wacky church banned all communications like that."
Michael raised his brows.
"How can they do that?"
"They did. I'm not a technical person, but they pulled it off."
"How do you guys use your cell phones or send text messages?"
"No text messages. We use older landline phones. Push button. But all calls get screened through them. All the lines go through a central hub, and they listen to everything. Let me know before you call anyone, lest the precious overlords at the temple become angry."
A sinking sensation filled Michael's stomach. It would be a long summer in this crap hole of a town. He stared at the no service icon on his phone again and slipped it into his pocket as they drove about halfway into town and then turned left at the main intersection. The Four Corners had an old hardware store, a small grocery store, a rundown furniture store, and an old brick building that was City Hall. They passed places Michael remembered from his previous visit, like the post office and the old high school. Two more white vans passed them.
"There's the church that's blocking your phone,"
his grandfather said, pointing left at a small white church on a hill at the end of the block. Two flights of cement steps led up to large arched doors. A bell tower crowned an aging steeple, and above it all sat a wooden cross. It looked like any other small-town church, except for the chain-link fence surrounding the perimeter of the property and the uniformed guard standing in front of the gate at the bottom of the stairs. Two more white vans sat parked on the street. Michael didn't understand how a crappy little church like that could block everyone's cell phone signals. He glimpsed the apple orchard stretching out behind the church. His grandmother had taken him to that orchard once, and he'd picked fresh apples straight from the tree. He couldn't recall a fence around it back then. They passed a cemetery on the left, which stretched back to the edge of the apple orchard, and then they turned right onto a gravel road, bouncing and rattling him like the airplane turbulence he'd endured earlier that day. He was as far away from civilization as he could get. Not a fun thing to do in sight. The tires kicked up rocks and shot them against the underside of the car. The car crunched across the gravel road and drowned out any possibility of a conversation. Not that he had anything to say. His grandfather turned up the music on the radio, which had played in the background throughout their trip, like a rhythmic whisper. The cornfields sprawled in every direction. The corn stalks stood at eye level, each row forming a living grid of green, waving at him as he passed. After a few more minutes, Michael spotted his grandparents' house up ahead. It was within walking distance of town, a long walk from the center, but it might as well have been in another country. He wouldn't have access to a car to get around in, not that he wanted to drive anywhere. The house was small and white with two floors. It resembled a large painted box. A small one-car detached garage sat at the end of the driveway. Several tall pine trees lined the edge of the property next to the driveway, and a little beyond the house was an old barn. But they'd rented it out to another family in town, who raised cattle in the pasture behind their house. The cows had been the highlight of his trip years earlier, since he'd never seen one before in real life, much less gotten close to one. But that spark was gone now. Were they milk cows or beef cows for eating? If they were cows to eat, then how could such an ugly animal taste so good? His face tightened in a grimace when he imagined slicing one up on his plate. He'd expected to be gagging from the smell of cow poop as he had years earlier. But now the air was clean. His grandfather had told him how farmers covered their fields with manure in the spring to help the crops grow. He'd cringed. He might be eating food that had been grown in cow shit. The no service icon on his phone never went away. His cell phone battery was almost dead anyway after the long trip. Someone in the town had to be connected to the internet. How could anyone survive without it? Before they pulled into his grandfather's driveway, they passed a small one-level house with a large forest behind it. Bex's house, and the forest where they had played years earlier. His grandfather's only neighbor was a short walk away. As a preteen, the distance between them was like traveling to another town. But now the roads and fields and farms appeared smaller. After they parked, Michael stepped out of the car and stretched, trying to remember why he had agreed to come in the first place. After his grandfather turned off the car, the lack of noise startled him. Birds chirped, and a light wind brushed against his face, but aside from the cows, no other cars or people were within sight. The sun shone on his face as he walked beneath a large tree next to his grandfather's parked car and toward the house's back door. Back home, he would have spent a sunny day like today cruising around town, smoking weed in the back seat with his friends. His grandfather opened the trunk and lifted Michael's two suitcases out onto the driveway. The larger one was super heavy, jammed full of clothes and his favorite graphic novels, and he had struggled to carry both through the airport earlier that morning. He couldn't let his grandfather carry his bags.
"Oh, sorry, Grandpa,"
he said, reaching for the heaviest suitcase.
"I got them,"
his grandfather replied, gesturing for him to get inside. Michael grabbed the larger suitcase anyway and plodded with it across the driveway to the back door. He went inside the house, expecting his grandmother to be waiting for him in the kitchen, but she wasn't there. He set his suitcase beside a row of worn-out boots. A dark-haired woman came out of his grandparents' bedroom with a wide grin on her face. He recognized her, although he didn't make a connection right away.
"Michael?"
She paused.
"Don't you remember me?"
He tilted his head.
"Yes," he lied.
"Rebecca's mom."
Bex. The memories flashed through his mind. During his family's last visit, she gave out ice cream treats on a hot summer day and took his family to visit the town's post office, where she'd worked as a clerk. Michael nodded.
"Where's Bex?"
"She goes by Rebecca now. She's in town with a friend."
His grandfather walked in the door with a smaller suitcase.
"Audrey's been helping take care of your grandmother," his grandfather said.
"Rebecca's looking forward to seeing you again," Audrey explained.
Michael nodded.
"You're so grown up," Audrey said.
"Your grandmother's taking a nap," his grandfather clarified. "We'll have supper tonight at Audrey's house while the nurse stops by to check on your grandmother."
"Is Grandma okay?"
Audrey's smile dropped, and she looked at his grandfather. His grandfather took a step toward him and looked into his eyes.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.